that Western civilization is passing through a period of crisis is something that is evident even from a superficial consideration. It is also equally clear that the present crisis is much greater than any other we can compare it with in the past. And that is so because of the spread of the modern spirit into new manifold branches, in which all of which, almost equally, the critical moment is seen. These opening sentences of Evola's first major philosophical work, Saggi sul Idealismo Magico, published in 1925, indicate how from the outset of his writing career his target was the modern spirit, and it remained so throughout. By 1925, in his mid-20s, Evola had already tried military life, the study of engineering, and the practice of art, and had begun to seek solutions to his existential dilemma in Eastern religious thought, in drugs, and in esoteric ritual. But he was also reading Italian, German, and French philosophy, and was engaged in Italian political and cultural life, mainly in Rome. He did not aspire to a university post, though. Nevertheless, his cultural milieu still mattered enough to him at this stage to want to demonstrate the complete failure of Italian professional philosophy of the time to resolve the major cultural issue of the day, which was the crisis of civilization occasioned by the spread of the modern spirit. Essays on magic idealism may be regarded as his first attempt to discuss in their own terms, to demolish and to move beyond the dominant influences in European culture of the period, which he followed with Phenomenologia dell'Individuo Assoluto, a more densely argued and less polemical version of his philosophical approach. For him, the dominant influence at this stage, the primary target, was idealism in its various forms. However, his relationship with European idealism, and especially its Italian variant, was complex. In the 1920s and 1930s in Italy, the two major philosophers, who between them dominated academic philosophy, pedagogy, historiography, and cultural, political, and social comment, were Giovanni Gentile and Benedetto Croce. It is difficult to overstate the weight of Croce and Gentile in the world of Italian letters at this time. Gentile, already a leading philosopher by the end of the war, was an early supporter of fascism, and as Minister of Education in the 1920s, introduced major reforms to Italian schooling that remained in the force long after 1935. Croce, an opponent of fascism and a figurehead of liberal political thought and idealist philosophy, maintained his cultural influence through his enormous scholarly output, and especially through his editorial influence in La Terza, one of Italy's leading publishers. Evola wanted to be taken seriously by both, and at the same time wanted to achieve real influence over Mussolini. Later, during the war, he had hopes that aspects of Nazi culture might be fertile ground for his vision of pan-European traditionalist state. He failed to achieve lasting influence either in Germany or in Italy. Neither Croce nor Gentile can be said to be major influences even in contemporary Italy, still less internationally, notwithstanding recent attempts at rehabilitation of Gentile and Croce's historical appeal as a profound influence on Italian culture in the 20th century. Italian philosophy of the day, dominated by academic neo-Hegelianism, he described later as a world of puffed-up rhetoric. What was repellent to me, then, was the coexistence of the petit bourgeois type, the salaried teacher, married and conformist, with the theory adopted by him of the absolute ego, the free creator of the world and of history. The use of the phrase absolute ego in this context makes it clear that he was referring to the ideas of Gentile, if not to him in person. His understanding of the difference between his thinking and that of Gentile is revealing. In Gentile's work, transcendence is an intellectual exercise only, taking place on an abstract plane and driven by logic, having no bearing or consequences for real existence, whereas for Evola, transcendence in its proper sense is a concrete realization of the absolute, a process in which empirical existence is really transfigured. In the same passage, he wrote of Croce and Gentile's incomparable poverty and emptiness, to which Gentile added a vague wordiness and an intolerable paternalistic pedagogical style. He never returned to the narrowly philosophical issues especially of epistemology and ontology that he covered at length in these works. Though development and sometimes substantial change can be seen over the course of the 50 years of his writing career, it seems clear that he did not fundamentally alter the views expressed here, and they continued to inform his more directly political and cultural writings thereafter. Hanson argues, to Evola, the center of all things is not man, but rather the transcendent. Regardless of the question that concerns him, he is always searching for the direct relationship to the absolute. This is as obvious in essays as it is in his later work. If he did not return to the essays at any length later, it was not because he saw no purpose in them, but rather the reverse, that he saw no purpose in revising them. They constitute his attempt to take on the Italian academic establishment of philosophy, especially Giovanni Gentile, and to persuade both the academic philosophers and the fascist leadership of the need and opportunity for a principled change of direction towards his brand of transcendental conservatism. It is noteworthy that neither of these works has any substantial reference to tradition, and this is no doubt one of the reasons why they have been mainly neglected by commentators. After 1930, having failed to make inroads against the ranks of Italian idealists led by Gentile, he turned his attention more directly towards the fascist leadership, and in his best-known works wrote as if trying to explain underlying principles of political strategy rather than principles of philosophy. It was typical of Evola, both, that he began his work, as it were, by confronting the philosophical masters of the era, Gentile and Croce. He failed to unseat them. Gentile's position as fascism de facto official philosopher waned and strengthened over the period, but that was not the responsibility of Evola. Croce was already opposed to fascism, and therefore deprived of political influence of the kind Evola sought. He did not need to engage with him on that level. At the more philosophical level, there is polite correspondence between Croce and Evola, suggesting a complete absence of meeting of minds. Croce was untouched by Evola's attempted radical turn in philosophy, possibly because the two were so distant from one another, he did not take it seriously. With Gentile, Evola reported later that he found him less approachable and not as gentlemanly as Croce. Evola's move on to other targets may therefore also have been influenced by his failure, for different reasons, to get either of Italy's two leading philosophers of the period to take him seriously. In the discussion that follows, I rely mainly on the earliest of his monographs dealing with his philosophical foundations, Essays on Magical Idealism. I use it because it seems to me to cover all the major elements of the two other books, Phenomenologia and Theoria, and in a more accessible fashion. Substantially, his philosophy did not change from Magical Idealism to the other two, and these three together provide the explanation and working out at great length in the latter two of his fundamental principles. A critical distinction to be noted from the outset is that between the ego, Leo, always capitalized, and the individual, l'individuo, usually not capitalized. Evola's term Leo, adopted from the idealist philosophy, is strictly translated as the I. The ego is used in an idealist sense to mean the thinking subject. The individual is used to mean the personal self, the core of experiences that make up our material identity. This is not an unusual distinction in Italian idealist thought, and only becomes problematic in this context when Evola took to referring to the absolute individual, l'individuo assoluto, in ways that invest the individual with much greater significance than the usage in Italian idealism entails. When used in this way, Evola is referring not only to the material identity, but also to the potential of the individual for transcendence. Evola drew a direct connection, a real causal link, between the limitations and weakness of idealist philosophy and the crisis of the modern world, but argued that the closing down of this mode of thought, of idealism, contained within itself the possibility of new superior spirit. To this epochal change, he gave the name Magical Idealism. This is the core argument of Essays. This link between the superficial material world and the real world of the spirit that creates it, a spirit which he later identified with tradition, is of critical importance in understanding Evola's entire approach. This aspect of his thought, with the other major followers of the tradition of the time, especially Genon, whatever their differences, Genon and Evola shared the view that the crisis of the modern world was spiritual in its causes, in its consequences, and in its resolution. However, we can also see the influence of idealism in his disagreement with Genon over the respective merits of Eastern and Western spirituality. This disagreement centered on Genon's argument that the highest form of spiritual achievement lies in passive contemplation. In this, the individual achieves complete union with the supreme eternal spirit. Genon argued that this has been lost entirely in the West. Evola argued, on the contrary, that the Western approach by active pursuit of higher values through direct engagement in the outside world was superior, had not been entirely lost, and could be recovered in the West through its own resources. In this context, his understanding of the process of enlightenment emphasized the creative capacity of the subject in the act of knowing. What the individual is creating is not only the object, but also himself, transforming himself and transcending his own individuality as he achieves ever closer proximity to the Supreme Being. The idea of the active subject was one that Evola never lost. For him, all thought was in principle an act of unconditioned creation. One of the major sources of the disagreement between Genon and Evola lay in their radically different epistemologies. For both, the path to knowledge lay in the achievement of ever greater proximity to, and eventually union with, the Supreme Eternal Spirit. For Genon, this was a work of intuitive understanding analogous to the contemplation, essentially passive, while for Evola, it was a process of continual active creation of the spiritual world. Thus, whereas in Genon's elaborations, the work of rebuilding that has to follow the final collapse of the modern world is a work of priestly caste marked out by their passive intuitive understanding of the true principles of tradition, Evola's approach requires a creative renewal undertaken by the warrior caste. In essays, Evola's logic is that idealism must be the only acceptable theory of knowledge, but that contemporary idealism is only half the answer. The identity of the absolute ego is central to proper understanding in the idealist conception, as the stable foundation on which truth and certainty have to be based. This, the identity of the absolute ego, is therefore also the solution to the epistemological problem of the foundations of knowledge. Whereas for the modern world, certainty lies in grasping of really existing external reality in conditions of absolute objectivity, in idealist philosophy, it lies in the absolute subjectivity of knowledge, meaning the unconditioned creation of the object by the subject. At this point, Evola is not only already ascribing genuine creative power to the absolute individual, but is referring to this in the singular, the creator of the world, of history, and of the heavens, the Supreme Being, though this is a term found more often in the more explicitly religious work of Genon than in Evola's secular language. According to Evola, in contemporary philosophy, the absolute ego is furiously ambiguous. It takes one of two forms, either the god of theistic belief or the real ego, l'io reale, sometimes referred to also as the empirical ego, l'io empirico, the quality of selfhood as it is lived through and in every experience. Neither of these two can qualify as the io assoluto correctly posited by idealism as the creative center of reality in Evola's view. The human individual, as understood by idealism, does not have the real and absolutely free powers attributed to the thinking subject, and the theistic deity is by definition divorced from human experience and therefore from human knowledge. Evola argues it is no solution to attempt to fuse these two principles, the real and free creative power and the immanent activity of the thinking subject, by reference to a transcendental I, at least not in the sense in common use. The relationship to the real ego is viewed by Evola as an avoidable constraint, so long as idealism remains theoretical and abstract. If the transcendental ego is the real ego, it remains important, because trapped in contingency of the material world. If it is not, it can have no real existence beyond the abstract and conceptual. Idealism is only half the solution, because on the theoretical level, this problem is unresolvable, and idealism, in the abstract, is therefore neither true nor false. Transcendental philosophy postulates the principle of truth on the intellectual level. For it, truth is contingent. Unconditioned truth can only come from that activity, itself genuinely unconditioned, by which the individual generates the principle within himself in a living and concrete reality. This is not one of Evola's clearest and most accessible statements, but it is one of his most important in this work. As becomes apparent from the passages immediately following this, his argument in this context is mainly against idealists, including Giovanni Gentile, for whom the empirical individual is something to be denied, repressed, rendered subordinate to an external higher principle. Since he seeks to emphasize that the solution is spiritual, he also takes issue with what he refers to as the right Hegelians. In the same context, he refers to British idealists Edward Kurt and Thomas Hillgreen, and to Maurice Blondet, the French personalist philosopher. The readiness with which he combines these very different approaches on the same side of the argument is puzzling and far from persuasive. These, however, are all almost throwaway references useful to Evola only because they appear to him to seek to resolve this problem by identifying the absolute ego with the god of vulgar religious consciousness, so that idealism becomes an introduction to religion. This option merely leads to an entirely dualistic understanding, based either on abstraction or on pure emotion, divorced from the real determinations of the empirical ego. The abstractions of right Hegelians, British idealists, and French personalism, so allusively referred to, are only the counterpoint to his solution. If idealism is to have meaning, that is, if it is to provide more than half of the solution, it must be embedded in the individual and based on the capacities of the real ego to create its own world. The ego must understand that everything that seems to have a reality independent of it is nothing but an illusion caused by its own deficiency. One of many obvious objections to this, in this case, an objection addressed implicitly, is that when the object is thought, it has no material reality, whereas realities understood as independent of ourselves may be experienced as material. Evola's answer to this is that the difference between what is thought and what is real is the difference between essential being and existential being. One is merely possible, the other actually exists, but the difference is quantitative difference, not a qualitative difference. It is a matter of gradations in power of judgment, gradations that are increasingly deep and intense, but between which there is continuity and liberty may figure in each of them in a different way. Insofar as we suffer the effects of the material world, for example by being struck by lightning, this is the direct result of our failure to be completely the cause of our own world, the absolute ego. Coterminus in Evola's argument with the eternal spirit, experienced in the real world as tradition, is fully the cause and creator of its own world, and has no deficiency such as to make it dependent on apparent external reality, because there is no real reality external to it. Evola does not object to this being understood as a form of religious value, so long as the religion is nothing like modern institutional or fideistic practice and belief. If, therefore, by the religious solution, one does not mean the abandonment of all intellectual positions, the bankruptcy of all coherence and of all certainty in the thin stoicism of faith, such a solution must be taken to refer to a mystical process, or better, a magical process. In this, God is nothing but a phantasm when he is not generated within ourselves, and when he is generated by words, concepts, fantasies, and pretty sentiments, rather than with a movement that is absolutely concrete. In this, that is, empirical existence is really transfigured and resolved into divinity. This is only religious and idealist in Evola's particular sense, and these were both terms that he later dropped from his vocabulary, at least in any positive sense. The negative form of the phraseology does not help clarity, but appears to be adopted by Evola deliberately, here and elsewhere, as if to demonstrate how much he is moving away from the conventional usages of the period and what their limitations are. It is significant, however, that he uses these terms at all. In this earlier period, he was still seeking to establish himself as a voice within the idealist and fascist cultural movement. His shedding of the terminology in later work and its disappearance from post-war interpretations, including posthumous ones, can be interpreted as the result of the failure of this tactic. If we ignore these early formulations, however, we neglect an important and, in these works, obvious source of his ideas. The post-war and posthumous interpretation of Evola, whether friendly or critical, has tended to downplay the influence on him of Italian idealism, and more generally of mainstream French and German normative philosophy. The argument has tended to focus on his synthesis of Western nihilism and Oriental esotericism. As essays on magical idealism makes clear, the foundations of his understanding of how we think and of what our selfhood consists of derive from his response to European idealism. His synthesis is the solution to his dissatisfaction and to his impatience with the abstractions of academic philosophizing of the period, especially its failure to provide meaning and certainty outside the schemes of logicians and abstract speculation. His understanding of tradition as an eternal spirit of supra-individual character, achieved by individuals appropriating and mastering the limitations of their own empirical individuality, differentiates him radically, both from the passive contemplative approach of Genon and from the mainstream of European traditionalism as expressed by De Maistre, Lamennais, and de Bonald. It is the idealism that provides him with the arguments to integrate creativity and liberty, deems notably absent from the more static approaches found in thinkers with whom he otherwise found common cause. The issue is not how convincing his arguments are. Like others similarly inclined, he found some of the arguments he was looking for in Buddhism and in Western nihilism, but the original element is his shaping of a justification for reactionary activism, and 20th century idealism provides him with the core concepts. This almost unique set of influences helps to explain his limited influence before 1935. Mircea Eliade, a traditionalist of a different kind, but sympathetic to Evola, commented in a review of Rivolta, written in 1935. We can say that this work is situated on the same cultural line as Gobineau, Chamberlain, Spengler, Rosenberg. With much more rigor, however, though this may seem paradoxical, Evola has not forgotten and has not renounced his earlier work. He is the most philosophical, but in totally unusual manner. Magical idealism taken to its extreme limits is a difficult food to digest. We know from his many other writings that Eliade was much more interested in the experience of the sacred than in tradition as such. It seems that what he found most difficult to digest in Evola's writing in Rivolta was the notion of reality as created by the individual insofar as he shares in the supreme being. The critical point at which Evola breaks ranks with idealists and lays the foundations for his novel understanding of tradition is the essays, as Eliade recognized. How this encounter with idealism influenced his thinking becomes clearer in the section in Essays where in typical Evola fashion he tilts directly and explicitly at Giovanni Gentile. Modern idealism can be defined in this way: a profound demand for absolute self-realization, which however the individual does not adopt directly from within, rather simply recognizes, apprehending it from outside as a phenomenon which the individual forms on abstractly rational plane. In Giovanni Gentile, this situation appears particularly clearly. Later, in the same passage, Evola returns to phraseology already used to illustrate what a real pure act would mean. If Gentile were really able to call the individual the pure act of his own rationalism, then he would show himself to be not a university professor whose actualism is limited to educational reform, but that cosmic centrality which esoteric knowledge exemplifies as a yogi, a rishti, a Christ, or a Buddha. This is the whole difference between the contemporary idealism and magical idealism. In Gentile's thought, the pure act of thinking by which the object is thoroughly resolved into the subject is how we overcome otherness. Reality is therefore not merely what is thought, since that would imply the existence of something other, but is the act of thinking itself. Evola goes beyond this. He agrees with Gentile that reality is the process of self-realization itself, not the creation of something external, and argues that the pure act of reality can only be found in the world of the really real, the world of the sacred. This process is transcendence. The core of Evola's objection to idealism was that idealism treats transcendence as purely epistemological and not ontological. It is difficult to imagine an idealism in the accepted sense of the term which did not do so, since in the idealist conceptual framework, the world of knowing has to be regarded as prior to the world of being. In asserting the case for ontological transcendence, Evola was cutting himself adrift from mainstream idealism explicitly. From idealism, however, especially from Italian idealism, he adopts much of the terminology relating to cognitive theory, which in his hands is used to develop not a variant of a speculative theory of knowledge, but rather a complex and highly normative metaphysics. This hybrid metaphysics differentiates him not only from continental European academic philosophy, but also from other followers of tradition who would have agreed with him about the primacy of being, but who had great difficulty with his rejection of the typical knowledge as contemplation approach to understanding. In view of his unusual point of entry into the debate, it is also not surprising that he has much to say about the importance of liberty, another theme in which thinkers such as Genon and Eliade did not have much interest. Evola ties the concept of liberty into the role of initiation. In the early sections of the essays, Evola argues that liberty lies in the unconditioned act of the will, which is found in the pure act of being. Any act of will that is not unconstrained, which means all such acts for almost all humans, is defective to the extent that it is constrained. Instead of being autonomous and self-realizing, the constrained will is dependent on something outside the individual, expressing representation of phenomena, not the creativity of the will in the pure act. Almost all of us remain passive recipients of representation of phenomena derived from others, not derived from our own free pure act. For the chosen few who are capable of transcending the material world, attainment of the really real, that is, of the higher plane on which pure being subsists, is achieved through the process briefly referred to as initiation. In other works, Evola describes initiation in detail as variously as spiritual alchemy, which for him was the true meaning of the term alchemy, or a reawakening. It can only be achieved by raising one's being to a different plane through asceticism, broadly understood as a testing of physical, mental, and moral extremes. The process of achieving a different, higher consciousness entails and is synonymous with reaching ever-increasing unity with the Absolute. But whereas in Genon's this is a form of passive possession of and possession by a universal spirit, in Evola's thought this is expanding participation in the Absolute individual understood as unconstrained liberty, therefore as unconditioned power. This Absolute is the only source of truth, because it is the only source of being. This is one of the points in the argument where Evola brings together writers from very different backgrounds. For example, Carlo Michelstetter, from which Evola takes the distinction between rhetoric, in which meaning and value are taken from what is external to us, and persuasion, in which we give meaning to our world. Michelstetter believed that the path of persuasion, though a deep human need, was unachievable, and that the human condition of anguish, despair, and remorse for our insufficiencies was unavoidable. It is from Michelstetter that in the first chapter of Essays he derives what he refers to as a point of fundamental importance, which however involves him in rejecting Michelstetter's despairing nihilism. The individual must not flee from his own deficiency. He must not, by giving in to it in order to unburden himself of the weight and the responsibility, concede a reality, a reason, and a personality that it is a mere deprivation cannot have. He must not, therefore, extrapolate remit the reality lacking to the ego onto something else: matter, God, nature, universal reason, transcendental ego, etc. How this relates to the crisis of modern world is important. In Michel Stetter's work, since he believes we are unable to attain complete individual autonomy, to find our own individual paths, the paths of persuasion that give value to our individual existences, we are therefore prisoners of illusory external values. Evola, however, believes that we can resolve this by finding the divine within ourselves, thereby achieving transcendence. In Evola's thinking, persuasion is the process by which we give life to our own reality. This makes possible the active transformation of the world. In this process, for which I propose the term concrete or magical idealism, we must recognize the task of a future civilization and indeed the positive solution to the crisis of the modern spirit. We should note at this point, however, that this is in principle a spiritual activity, implying detachment from the world. It does not entail complete abstention from political life, for example, but it does require a total indifference to the values and norms of the modern world. Genon's criticism of this potentially active and transformative approach is based on fundamental disagreement on key principles of metaphysics. He held, as did many in traditional religions, that the absolute being is the immobile mover of all things, the fixed eternal point around whom all revolves. Stillness, silence, and constancy are attributes of the transcendental world. Action, change, and impermanence belong by definition to the temporal order. Therefore, the notion that transcendence can somehow be achieved through action in the temporal world is one that Genon could not accept. Genon's understanding had more in common with both Eastern and Western metaphysics than did Evola's, but this break with conventional understanding by Evola is of critical importance. It was this attempt to identify an active relationship between liberty, creativity, and the individual on the one hand, and the absolute eternal transcendent principles of tradition on the other, that distinguished Evola's thinking. It is this that enables him to develop understandings of transcendence that keep the individual as the firm focus of attention and the action of the individual in the empirical world as part of the process of transcendence. It is important to understand that liberty in this context does not mean what it might mean in the liberal idealism of Benedetto Croce. Evola's understanding of liberty is one of the themes by which he shows how much he has departed from the world of 19th and 20th century political thought, but it is significant that he pays attention to it at all. The core question for Evola is how the individual can make his world real, for only in this way can he give it meaning. We have already seen that Evola argues that everything that is apparently independent of the ego is an illusion. In considering how magical idealism is developed by Evola, it is important to understand that his belief in real or ontological transcendence is not a matter of rhetoric or metaphor. It implies a view of the world radically at odds with all contemporary positivism and rationalism. How, one might ask, can the individual be regarded as causing what appears to us as the material world, a world that is shared furthermore with other humans and whose material forces appear beyond our control? As we have seen, Evola argues that the difference between the image of a material phenomenon and its empirical reality must be grasped as a quantitative difference, a difference of degree, not of quality. All material reality is no more than the expression of suprahuman forces operating on the level of the sacred, the spiritual plane. Insofar the individual is subject to such forces, he is subject to the material world. Insofar as he transcends the material world, he participates in the absolute and is directly causing to be what was not. He does so as a human individual, not as a human who loses identity by participating in something external to himself, but as someone who becomes more himself and more than human. Causality in this context has to be understood in a pre-modern sense. To give reality to what was not real requires the individual to grasp that to say that a thing is not caused by me is not the same that it is caused by another. In this way of thinking, to cause a thing is to give it a meaning and value through one's own activity. What is not caused by me is no more than that. It is an absence of my causality, a lack of my activity. To say, wrongly for Evola, that a thing not caused by me is more than that, more than a mere absence or lack, because it is caused by someone or something else, is to ascribe to it a positive character, and therefore to allow that what is not my own reality to have meaning and value outside of me, to accept a world of rhetoric, in Michel Stetter's words. This is opposed to the real world of a persuasion, in which all that exists is internal to me, a product of my giving meaning to what was mere lack of meaning. In this way, what was experienced as necessity becomes liberty, self-affirmation, and actuality. In the world of modern realist understanding, all that is external and other to me is regarded as having a positive existence and a reality of its own. It is therefore beyond my responsibility, and I implicitly accept that I cannot give it a meaning, because I cannot make it absolute and unconditioned. In contemporary understanding, the voids of my being, I vuoti del mio essere, are the responsibility of others. If we understood properly, however, that is, if we really grasp the nature of being, we would grasp that the entire world is a demand by being to the ego, that this in its potentiality should activate being, and in that should redeem it from want, should make it real. In this way, I fill the voids of my being by making unconditioned and real that which I initially grasp as conditioned and as potentiality. Prior to my act, what is incomplete and imperfect has no being. This does not mean it is mere negativity, because that would imply that the absolute, the unconditioned that is generated from it, in some sense denied its own origins. What I act upon is not negation, but potentiality that has within it the demand for the absolute. Something that is not caused because it is a limitation of my causality. The process of making real is therefore a synthesis of the act and the potentiality in which the act produces something new. Something that did not exist previously. That is, something that was not previously caused. There is a separate issue which cannot be dealt at length here, but which I merely note in passing, though this constitutes a rejection of contemporary epistemology in favor of a traditionalist metaphysics. Followers of tradition, among whom Evola certainly numbered himself, are often concerned to relate their arguments to sometimes unexpected sources. So in the essays, when discussing this transcendental metaphysics, Evola, as an unexplained aside, says, "This is the deep reasoning of Aristotelianism, that magical idealism reaffirms in the clearest manner." It is true that the traditionalist metaphysics in Evola's hands uses Aristotelian terminology. Not all followers of tradition would have agreed with Evola in this, and it is not relevant at this stage to argue about the ways in which this 20th century approach departs from Aristotle's. What traditionalists would have found familiar in this, however, is the notion that there is an esoteric meaning, a hidden and deeper truth in much ancient philosophy that the modern world has lost the capacity to grasp. If contemporary philosophy disputes this meaning, that is merely a demonstration of how much has been lost and of how restricted is the number of those capable of moving beyond the exoteric significance to the esoteric. Michel Stetter's pessimistic logic was that when confronted with the apparently inexorable inflexibility of non-being that nevertheless appears to have being, of non-reality that nevertheless appears real, the individual would be swept away in the moment of revelation. No act of human will could be strong enough to give actuality and value to the infinite lack and void around him. Evola's answer is that the process must be seen not as a blinding moment of revelation, but as a multiple process of meditation. Evola here, as in other parts of his work, could reasonably be interpreted as extrapolating a complex theoretical position from his own experience, in particular from his crisis in his early 20s. These experiences further aggravated his need for intensity and absoluteness, and as we saw, he considered taking the same route as Michel Stetter and Otto Weninger, that of suicide. Having been saved from this by a deep spiritual experience, he changed as a person and became stronger, he says, but continued to feel the impulse to take every experience to its limit, and in fact, the tensions did not diminish with the years. He referred to this as an existential situation, borrowing the term explicitly from the existentialist writers, whom he only came to know later, Kierkegaard, Jaspers, and Heidegger. And by this he means that paradoxical coexistence in action of what is conditioned and what is unconditioned. There are two additional issues to note briefly here. One is his insistence on the path as a process of increasing liberty, a modern concept. The other is that, as he describes it, the sense of inability to give meaning to one's life is an increasing process of crisis and is not felt as a climactic blow. The beginning of the route out of it may be a sudden event, such as he experienced, but it is one on which one has to build to mediate in daily life, a force that cannot be contained within it. Truth is a reflex of power. Truth is a strong error. Error is a weak truth. From the point of view of the fully integrated ego, something is not wanted because it is recognized as right, rational, or true. It appears right, rational, or true because it is wanted.